I will tell you a little about the Swedish school system and the Swedish culture, a short one. You see what I trick you there? Yeah. Sweden, you know Sweden is? Somewhere north in the Europe. And we have Linneaus University is in two cities, Kalmar and Växjö, in the south Sweden. And our early year education program is 3.5 years. We call it preschool program because our students will be preschool teacher. We always talk about preschool, so you understand this early childhood for you, I think. And we have about 250 students every autumn, new students. So it's many preschool teachers going out. It looks like this. We have a preschool, it's for 1 to 5 years. No one is, everyone have been turned one when they start in the children to five. And then they can go, then they go to preschool class. And the preschool teacher can work in both these schools, preschool and preschool class. But this is new because the last autumn, the preschool class get compulsory. So nowadays we have a 10 years compulsory school. It's very new. And then we have also, it's different, I think, from you. We have a leisure time center. This is school before school, after, before and after. Like child caring, but it's part of the school also. So the teacher in leisure time center, they also teach subjects in middle of the day, perhaps sport, music, art. And they also assist the teacher in primary school and preschool class. And mostly of the teenager, almost everyone go to upper secondary school is 3 years. And preschool is a little special, I think, because all children is included with special needs. But in preschool class and primary school, we have special schools also. We also have special school, compulsory school for Sami schools. That is our indigenous people in North Sweden, Norway, Finland, and Russia. That is very north. You can see some figures. Mostly of the small children is attend preschool, 83%. The groups is about 20 children, three teachers. But everyone of the adults is not teacher. They have no teacher education. Only 39% is too low. That's a big problem just now. In Kalmar, where we live, is still 66%. But in the whole Sweden, it's a big problem. And it's only 5% who is men. That is also, we don't like that. We want more. I don't know how it is here. 2%? Yes, be a little better. Good. When we're in ranking, Swedish preschool system is very high ranking. And that's because we have a very, I think it's a very unique welfare system. It's not so much about the quality in teaching, it's more about the system, how we support the parents. The school is free, even in the university, but childcare have fees. But we have a maximum fee. That means that parents with low income, they don't have to pay anything for caring. But if you are rich parents, they behave a lot, we think, but if I compare, it's not so loud. I think it's $200 New Zealand dollars a month. That's the most. I think it's different. But this is a very strong idea. And we also have, especially, it's a parents' leave, because we don't need any school for children who is not 1 year. The parents can be home for one and a half years if they want. But they also can have this day, they stay home to 1 year, and they can use it to the children of 12 years. And here's, you also think very much about gender, so those parents must be home. They cannot take each, 90 days must the other parents use. It's a good idea, I think. Perhaps a little unique. Yes. Our curriculum for preschool is connected with the primary curriculum. The Swedish preschool is the first part of the education system. So some parts in the curriculum is exactly the same as in primary school. That's a part of values, fundamental values. But then we have goals for the teachers, not for the children. That is very important. So the children don't have to achieve anything, but we must support the learning. I think I don't talk about this. Lotta can explain that better than me. You have it in your presentation. But in some aspect, I think, little unique, very important in Sweden, some aspects. This is the idea about educare, that caring, playing, learning, that is not, you don't separate it. It's a whole. It's a very important idea. And I think it's a little the same here. I get very happy when I go around and visit your schools yesterday. I can see the same idea. And it's not so common if you look global. This picture about the iPads, we have a new curriculum for the preschool, and it's very important just now with digital. It's in English? Digital. Even for the 1 year old. But that is important. So the preschool curriculum is exactly the same from 1 year to 5 year. We must do the same thing. Outdoor, I heard you talk with someone, you know we are outdoor a lot. But when I was here yesterday and visit your schools, I get so jealous because you have your door open, so children can go out and in when they want. Our children can not do that because we have a door closed. But we are on the other side outdoor a lot, even if it's raining, snowing, everywhere. And we also use the neighborhood where we go out in the city and use it to look for mathematics. We go out in the forest a lot. And we even have schools who are outdoor the whole day. When the winter comes, yeah, they used to go inside and eat when they need gloves, not before. So it's some months in the winter they must go inside and eat. But the children you can see in the down here, the children, it's very common that they're sleeping afterwards the whole year. So the new preschool, when they built a new building, they always built an area for sleeping outdoor. So it's a strong idea to be outside. Gender is also, perhaps I think it's typical for Sweden to talk a lot of gender. It's important in the curriculum to meet the boys and girls at the same way and give them the same possibilities. It's a very strong idea, even in our education. I think what this I want to say, yes, it's very short. Do you think something you heard about Sweden I don't talk about? We can have questions in the after. Yes, it's better not to take over, I think.
I represent a work in progress together with Libby Lee-Hammond, Murdoch University, Perth, Western Australia. I have made a, you can call it a case study, where we have investigated how early childhood educators in Sweden and Western Australia are making sense of pedagogical documentation. And, excuse me, so. Get it, yeah.
Yes, just click it.
Next. So, here's a map, and I'm sorry, you can't see New Zealand on it. But There is Kalmar, and here is Perth, and it's a long way by flight, and it's quite different context. And you will realize that when I continue to talk. So, the aim of the study is to contribute with knowledge about how some early child educators in Sweden and Western Australia talk about the practice in terms of quality work and the use of pedagogical documentation. And the context in Sweden and the context in Australia in West, differs, so I want to start to tell you a little about that. In Sweden, there is an Education Act and a national curriculum which has goals for the preschool to strive for and not for the child to achieve. And these goals specify the orientation of the preschool work and therefore the expected quality development in preschool. So it is the preschool practice who is going to develop. And you are going to assess the quality of the preschool practice by conducting a systematic quality work. And working with pedagogical documentation is common in Swedish preschools. In Australia, there is a national curriculum and an early years learning framework, a national quality standard, an on-entry assessment, and then the teachers work towards natural testing in year three. And in Western Australia, there is not a strong history of working with pedagogical documentation. That's different from Sydney and other places, cities where they're more common. But in Western Australia, it's not so common. And what kind of documentation have we researched? It's a kind of documentation which we call pedagogical documentation, which has its root in Reggio Emilia in Italy. And this documentation can consist of written notes, audio recordings, video recordings, photos and children's artwork. And something which is important is that it isn't a pedagogical documentation from the beginning. In the beginning, it is documentation, and it turns to be pedagogical documentation when it is reflected and used for making new decisions of how to proceed in order to challenge learning. And we have many preschools in Sweden which they say they work with pedagogical documentation, but actually it is documentation because they follow processes and they take photos, but they don't reflect and analyze, so it became a base for the next step. When pedagogical documentation works as it intends to do, it is a reflection tool which enables educators, children and parents to jointly discuss, interpret, and reflect about what happened from multiple points of view. And in our study, we have used Habermas as a theoretical framework, and Habermas is a social educational philosopher from Germany. And we have used specifically two of these concepts, and they are system and life word. When he is trying to understand the world we live our lives in, he looks at them from two perspectives, so it's not two different words. In preschool, there are things that influences what happens in the practice that the individual preschool teachers can't resist and change so easily. It's things that is decided in the system. It's about economy, how many staffs, how many children you should have in each space. It's the curriculum and a lot of things. And the life board, when Hammer talks about the life world, he is talking about the everyday life in the preschool. And sometimes the system and the life world don't cooperate so well. There can come things from the system that says that you have to do this and this and this, and the teachers in kindergarten wonder, oh, how shall we do to make this happen? And we will hear when I continue to tell you that the system, which differs in Australia and Sweden, contributes to that the teachers are talking in quite different ways of pedagogical interpretation, even if they have shared views too. There are 12 educators, 6 is from Sweden and 6 are from Western Australia, and we have chosen the educators based on that they are using some form of pedagogical documentation in the professional practice as early years educators. And we conducted semi-structured interviews, and we audio recorded them, and then Libby and I met in Australia, and we have met through Skype too, to jointly transcribe and analyze. And we think this was very important that we had this meeting, so because she has better knowledge about the Australian context and I have better knowledge about the Swedish, so we could check so we really interpret it in a way that was reasonable. And finally, it's about quality. Swedish early childhood educators, they describe quality as the work with the children. They talked about inviting the children to contribute to the documentation and actively reflect on it. So when they have done the documentations, following processes, and they had analyzed it and had talked about it, they took the documentation back to the group of children and show them and ask the children, what do you think? What ideas do you have? So these ideas from the children also was a base for what's happened next. But the Australian early childhood educators, they saw quality as the work about the children. They used pedagogical documentation to listen to children. And if you see this, you can think, oh, it seems like the Swedish educator has understand this in a better way. But then we have to use Habermas' ideas about the system and the life world, because the Swedish preschool teachers, they don't have to work so the children achieve some goals. But the Western Australian educators, they had to work in a way so that they can assure that the children have achieved certain goals. But there were some shared views about quality, and educators from both countries emphasizes the importance of listening to children, and they also talked about the learning environment. It's that is important for children's learning, relationships and interactions. And they also talked from both countries about children's interests. But it was only the Swedish educators that talked about children's hypotheses. Because the Australian teachers, they wanted to see if the child had understood the subject correctly in the right way, but the Swedish teachers could be more interested in the child's or the children's ideas. And they also said that it is for quality, it's very important that we as educators have a good knowledge base ourselves about the subject. And they saw documentation as a tool for professional development and they talked much about meet each other in network and share ideas. And why is pedagogical documentation important? In Sweden, the teachers talked about is the way to give you the practice. You can take what happened in this situation when you have recorded it or written down. You have this material with you in the room where you sit together and try to understand it. It's a way of revisit the practice. And they say that the pedagogical documentation help us to take different points of view and got new ideas, reflect and analyze. And different points of views, they mean, is easier when you have these documents. It's not just in one teacher's head. It's out of the head, and you can look at it in different ways. And they also talk about that pedagogical documentation make it easier for them to connect what you have been doing with what you will do. And they also said that pedagogical documentation is a way of some collective memory, help us to remember together. And one of the teachers said, everybody doesn't need to do everything, but everyone should have the opportunity to think about everything. And with that she meant that if a child didn't participate in something, when the child saw the documentation, the child could share his or her talk about what's happening, but the child also can say, oh, they're doing something that interests me. I want to do that too. And the Australian teachers, they talk most about documentation as a tool for checking rather than a tool to assist in deciding what to do. They were very concerned about children learning a specific topic. And they also give feedback to the children, but not in the same way as the teachers in Sweden who don't have to see that the children achieve goals. The Australian teacher could give feedback on how do you don't have understood this right yet. Yeah. And that kind of feedback. And they also talk very much about accountability to show the parents, to show the principals and the municipalities that they were doing what they were expected to do. So one of them said, pedagogical documentation is important so children understand the content. Educators from both countries, they share the view that documentation is important for reflecting on pedagogy to understand how their own actions as educators influence what happens in the practice. They talked about if I can't assess what the child can about the content if the practice haven't offered the child to learn something about this content. So when you look at the documentation, you can see what the child and the group of children do, but you can also see what you do yourself or what you don't do. And when we ask them what they make visible and assess, the Swedish educator emphasizes the project. They work on a special theme with the children during a period. And they also said that they document for themselves, but also for the children. And they used it to give the documentation back to the children. And they say that the pedagogical documentation is a tool for working more effectively and reflectively and not for accountability. And one of them said, I don't like the word assessment. I don't want to judge and put forward this is a fact about the child. In Swedish preschool, the preschool teachers are very afraid for the word assessment. They say, oh no, we don't assess in preschool, they do it in compulsory school. That's not true. There's a lot of assessment in preschool too. But they didn't want to say that the child is like this because they think that if we are talking about children in that way, the child have to show that him or herself in that way. The Australian educators emphasize subject learning and observing individual children's development of skills. And they document more for an external audience, so they can take off, just as I said earlier. And one of them say, I do have a scope and sequence I need to do in English and maths, so I have the usual thing, like I know I've got to prepare them for, syllables, and I've got rhyming and phonics, explicit teaching. And it's very important that we have in mind what Habermas said about the system. And the culture of setting and support for pedagogical documentation, they talked about too. And when working with pedagogical documentation towards improving quality, educators need support from school, from parents, and supporting organizations to develop a reflective culture. Both educators thought it was important. And they talked a lot of to have a supporting organization. In Sweden, there are several preschools who have decided to work with a project on Tuesday to Thursday, and on Monday and Friday, they meet in different groups, the team or cross teams, to analyze and reflect. And then they help each other on the whole picture to take care of the children. So some of them can sit together and concentrate on interpreting the documentation. In Australia, most of those who participated in the study said, I feel alone when it comes to reflection, because I'm working much by myself, and maybe I have an uneducated assistant, so I can talk and reflect with this colleague. And the times I really have opportunity to meet other educators who work with pedagogical documentation, I really like it. It means so much to me. And also, the cooperation between educators is highly valued for sharing reflections and improving quality. And both Swedish and Western Australian educators struggle to get parents involved. It's not easy. In our curriculum, there is a paragraph that the preschool teachers should involve parents in the systematic quality work. And parents which are willing to do that, but there are many parents which choose not to. And that mustn't be because they don't want. We know that in society, it happens a lot of things. You work and you can have more children and so on, and you don't feel you have the time. But it's the educator's responsibility to explain the practice so clearly so the parents can have ideas. Because the parents isn't at the preschool time in Sweden all day. They are leaving in the morning and they pick up in the afternoon. And it's very difficult to take active part in systematic quality work if the preschool teachers can't tell about the practice in a clear way. But both teachers in Sweden and in Western Australia, they said that if the principal don't really understand what's important when you're working with pedagogical documentation, they can decide a lot of things which make it harder for them to work with pedagogical documentation. They think they have to struggle with the principal to get them to understand that we need to have some kind of organization that supports us. But if the principal or the head teachers do understand, they either get involved in a supportive way or they delegate and trust the educators that they do this in a good way, competently. But these teachers who had a principal that trusted them, some of them said, we don't want our principal to trust us so much. We want them to support us and work with us. So that's the result of this study.
So, hi everyone. My name is Lena, and we work on different institutions, Gunilla, Lotta, and I work with the visual arts. So, I thought I would just talk a little bit about how we find good arguments to keep on having quite a lot of aesthetic learning in both education when it comes to the universities, but also in the preschools. Because I think it's similar here than what we have in Sweden, that the government want to focus on more technique and maths and language, and the aesthetic subjects are getting lower and lower in importance. So one of the reasons that we come over here and we met up with Marek is that we would like for our students to be able to do exchange, maybe just the practical exchange, to do practicum in for 5 weeks in each other's countries, or to do a whole semester. So we think internationalization is very important for the students, especially nowadays. Not maybe always traveling a long, long way like we've been doing now, because it's not really sustainable to do that all the time. But we want the students to meet other cultures, and it can be arranged in different ways. Like we've met teachers here that we are talking about letting our students meet and discuss things. And when we are talking about learning in different ways for aesthetic learning, we want to really show that we can connect this to theory as well, because that's usually a very common thing that a lot of people think of the aesthetics as not being theoretical enough. So we are trying to, a professor in Sweden called Lars Lindström, and he's figured out 4 different ways of learning with aesthetics. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but I will do that through a course that we are giving and that we also offer the exchange students to participate with our Swedish preschool students, so they can do it together with them. And that's a 10-week full-time aesthetic course where we work with drama and we work with visual art. So with visual art, they will make their own children's books from the very beginning of writing stories, analyzing children's books, and creating all the pictures for it and printing it up to become a proper book. And with the puppets, they make puppets in drama, their own puppets, and they analyze puppet plays and how you can use a puppet as a pedagogical tool in the preschool. So we say that this whole course is to do with communication. And this is the way it can look when the students are starting to work with the books. So they visit libraries and they analyze children's books with focus on topics like gender, age, class, and ethnicity, for example. And they create the story and they make the pictures. And all the way along this, they have to connect with the curriculum as well, so they don't misuse or that they talk in a sexist or a racist way. We really put a lot of effort into that. So we use a lot of technique, but it's also very tactile the way they are working. So they make like a storyboard and things and make all the pictures. And we get an author, a children's author, to come and talk about how it is to work with books. Oh, sorry, how do I reverse now? I can do it on here. Hang on. I can do it like this. So, this is what they do when they are working, and it's parallel for all 10 weeks. So the students visit a theater, they analyze storytelling, learn about dramaturgy, and create their own puppets, put together a puppet show in groups, and then we invite preschool children. And we actually have Dave is from England, and Michelle is from New York. So here, they have learned a few Swedish phrases so they can communicate. That was the most nervous part from them. So this is what they do with the puppets. And all this, we can connect to Lars Lindström. And he says that we can learn about the arts, or in the arts, or with the arts, and through the arts. So these words, about, in, with, and through, you can use that in any situation. Like Lotta was talking about, the Swedish were working with the children, and the Australians were talking more about the children. So this we can find in a lot of different situations. So he has made up this image, and he's been connecting the goals and the means with the curriculum. And he's also talking about convergent and divergent learning, and medium specific and medium neutral. So he's placed all the four different ways of learning with these specific terms. So I'll go through that a little bit. So the goals are described as convergent or divergent. And convergent, that's when you teach the basic on a subject, like learning how to mix paint, learning about perspective, when it comes to art. So that's very specific, and it's goal-directed, focused, and rational. The goal is to achieve something that is given in advance. We already know the answers for it, but we want the children to learn about, or the students. But divergent learning is more explorative, open-ended, and intuitive. The goal is rather to combine what you already know to make it into a new knowledge or for new purposes. So you need this first to be able to continue this way. But we've found in preschools and in education, most people stay here. And most of the time, they also stay in the medium neutral. medium specific, that is to do with the arts. Learning emphasizes the forms of representation, such as visual art, or drama, and music. You stay within the subject. So that's the specific. Medium neutral, learning emphasizes is more instrumental aspects of learning about a certain theme. This can be done in different mediums. Like here, they are learning maths through art. Here, they are learning about maths through the body and with movement and things like that. So that's what they mean with medium specific and medium neutral. So up here, I have the same image, even though you might not be able to see. But learning about art refers to the basic of art education, from the elements and principles of design to knowledge about artists, styles, and genres. For example, how to mix colors or how to draw perspective. So that we could place, when we work like this with the students or the children, then it is that top corner that is red there. We work convergent and medium specific. And when it came to our book and puppet project, we wanted to see, did we use all these four ways of learning? So the book and puppet project, they were learning about painting and collage methods. They were learning about different materials. They were learning about different building techniques to make the puppets. Learning in the arts, that's the more divergent, the more experimental part of it. So that refers to experimenting with materials and techniques in order to achieve a visual effect or convey a message or express a mood. And in the book and puppet project, so they were learning special visual effects in art. They were learning special ways of expressing different moods in art. Like this student, she was going to talk about the child who lost her temper all the time. So that she found a way of expressing this. Learning special ways of conveying a message in art. So this is more experimental, and you need to know the basics to be able to do this. And learning with art often refers to the integration of art with subject matter from other disciplines. So that's what we call then convergent and medium neutral. And learning about children's books with art, learning about puppetry, learning about dramaturgy, learning about text and writing, or learning about gender, ethnicity with art. So that was the more medium neutral. And then learning through art often refers to the studio habits of mind, or making dispositions that students might acquire, like expressing, observing, envisioning. Or we also talk about what do they learn, what do they gain, the students or children, when they are working through art. Oh, they get more confident, they dare to speak in front of other people. And all this generic knowledge that you can gain through this as well. So that's the four different ways that he's talking about. That's a picture from one of the students' books that they were making, like a secret hidden place. So the intention with this course was to implement Lars Lindström's theories about the four aspects of aesthetic learning in theory and practice. And we did find that we used all these four ways of learning. And I can tell you, when the students have their book in their hand and they can go out to the practice and they tell their mentors and the children, yeah, this is a book that I have made myself, they have grown so much in their confidence as well. And they bring the children into our place and they play these puppets and the children get so engaged that they say, oh, I'm not going to be fearful of talking in front of parents any longer. I've managed this. So it's a really nice way of growing as a person as well, I think. And we would like New Zealand students to come and participate in this course as well. So that would be really nice. So that was all. Do you want to come up and we can answer questions?
The preschool is situated different around the city, but the preschool class is at the school area.
Yeah, by
saying. Yes. The 6 years, they go to the primary school. It's the same, and they are connected to each other. This is the first. It's a zero. Then they begin the first class, but this is a zero class.
Okay.
But it's the same school area, and the same leisure time center. So they meet the primary school students, pupils also.
So what we've discovered here is that a lot of parents who leave the children to ordinary centers or to the kindergartens, it's only between 9 and 2:30 maybe, and the parents have to arrange for the child to be taken care of the outside hours of that. But in Sweden, the children are taken care of the teachers, they take them to the lecture center, which is in the same area, so the parents can go to work and work the whole day without feeling frightened of the children. So I thought that was a big difference.
But
what happens when a parent would like to leave their
6-month-old
in care?
We have no caring for 6 months.
So it's not
the sixth. You must, the children must have turned one. You cannot get anything before that. Because we have the parental leave. Mm.
So is there, say, an option for
perhaps
a private nanny?
Perhaps someone have a private nanny, but it's not common. It can happen, but it's not common. Yeah.
But I can also say that every employee everyone who is employed have the right to use the parental leave. They can't be criticized at work for wanting to stay at home for a year or for 9 months, not the man or not the woman. So that is really strong. Even if you're high up in the employment scale, you are preferring to stay at home with your children, and it's totally okay with the employees.
And nowadays, the fathers, they are a little ashamed if they don't use more than the 3 months. It's a little shaming because it's positive to have been home.
Yeah, that was my question. So.
Yeah. Yes, but I don't think it is a question. They want to stay home and share to be home the first year. Everyone does that, so it's not a question. I think someone used nanny perhaps. They have a private office or private something, but it's not common. And don't know anyone.
They do organize a lot of collective things for parents who are home with the children, like baby yoga. You bring your baby with you and you do the yoga together with other parents and things. So there are a lot of things to do, and open preschools as well, where the parents stay with the child, with the kids as well. And of course, arrange something private. You can get an au pair or...
We have had before for younger children, but it's so long ago now. When it was 30 years, I think, 20 years perhaps, 30.
A full-time work at the preschool in Sweden is 40 hours a week. And then you are doing 37 hours working with children. And then you have time for parents meeting in the evening. You have time for staff meeting in the evening. And you have also time for planning as a team. And you have some hour for individual planning too. And when you talk about documentation in Sweden, there are two ways of thinking. A lot of preschool teachers think this is a strong tool who helps me to work in a way that I can give the children a more qualified practice and learning. But there are also teachers who says, when I'm documenting, I take time from the children. So that's both ideas. But those who think it's a strong tool which gains the children, they it's partly because they think they have a more reflective practice, and they also involve the children in the document the processes. But the preschool have solved the organization different. Some of them do, as I told you before, they work with the project 3 days, and then they organize 2 days a week as days when they focus on planning in their own teacher team, but also across the teacher team. Many preschool spaces in Sweden nowadays have children in different ages, in different spaces. So in a preschool, may you have 2 spaces for children age 1 to 2, and one time in the week, this team meet, and then another day in the week, everyone who works with in this preschool area, who works with children in this age, meet and talk.
So, and of course, this is only possible if you have quite a few staff. That's the difference, I think. If you are just 1 or 2 or something, you can't leave the group. So that is needed.
About 20 children and 3 teachers full time, but it can be 4 people. But it's full time. Yeah. But I, and I think
it's the older age.
Huh?
They have an elder older.
Yes, yeah, so it's smaller children. Less 15 children perhaps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
1 to 5 for the smaller ones.
Some preschools, they every space is concerned about their own space, and they don't cooperate so much with other spaces. But there are many preschools that have developed a way of thinking within this area. They think that, okay, I'm working with these children on this space, and you're working with those children on that space, but we have the responsibility for every child at this preschool, so we help each other. So sometimes we do things that there can be few staff and more children. For example, when you are outdoors, you can help look many children, and when you have gathered the children to sing, there can be many children to sing, and so on. So they really think, how can we help each other to get time for reflection together? And that, if you have that kind of organization, the preschool teacher often emphasize the strong side of documentation.
I think my experience when I have worked in the preschool, if you have a reflection culture and you have an idea, so it's so strong. So if you come new teachers that don't know anything about that, you are so strong to show them the culture and helping them into monitoring them. But some school, if they are not so sure about the idea, they can drop it.
Man frågar också om ledare och chefer inte hjälper till.
Yes, and my experience is if you are very, very strong, you can do it without the principals, the rector. But sometimes the headmaster rector is too strong and the teachers don't take the commando. So it's a balance there, I think. Yeah, but the idea is, if the idea is very strong, I think they get the energy to make it.
All I've heard, I've asked the students to reconnect with me once they finish their studies, and they are so proud to say, oh, this week I've had to order 10 more books because they all want to buy them, you know. So the preschool teachers out in the practice are really happy for it because it's got so clear intentions. It could be about loneliness or about escape or about being outside of a group. It's very clear stories. So they're very appreciated.
A lot of principals have sent their staff on courses. So it's not just the preschool teacher who is documenting. The preschool teacher is responsible for documenting the practice according to the curriculum. But the whole team has to be involved. And when there are a lack of preschool teachers, just maybe one in a preschool or so, or the preschool teacher become a supervisor who is in dialogue and have reflection, a conversation with the staff.
And I have an experience. When the school is working with pedagogical documentation, there will be more preschool teachers. They stay there. They think their job is interesting. They in the reflection culture. They don't want to leave. So this school who only have one teacher, it's low with reflection culture.
Well, we have to try and change the low figures of the teachers by creating more programs for the preschool teachers. So we've just started in our university this autumn, we'll start a program for people who've been working 5 years or longer in preschools without the education. So we make use of their knowledge and they can be still employed and they will come to do the program with us. So that's a long-term way of trying to solve the problem as well.
And who
pays for that? Well, the education, there is no cost at the university for it.
And these students, they are still working half time perhaps, so they're still working when they go to the university.
Yes, but there's
no
cost for university.
No.
Only literature.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In Norway, there is just one educated preschool teacher on each base. And the the Norwegian preschool teacher's task is to be the leader and supervise and challenge and her colleagues and so. So the Swedish preschool looked a bit towards Norway when we have so few. Mm. And in the education, we have realized that we have to give our students more courses in leadership, because they will be a leader to a higher degree than the teacher preschool role was before.